Booker has copped one of the biggest serves of his career, and it's been whipped in by Victoria Premier Daniel Andrews. He didn't name Novak Djokovic specifically, but his target was quite clear.
All the people who are watching the tennis at the Australian Open, they're going to be double vaxxed. All the people that work there are going to be double vaxxed. Stands to reason that if you want to get into the country to be part of that tournament,
yes,
then you should be double vaxxed as well.
So it leaves a big question mark now over whether the world number one will make it to Melbourne at all, as he still refuses to reveal his vaccine status. For more, we're joined by Shadow Minister for Government Services Bill Shorten and 4BC's Scott Emerson. Good morning to you both. Bill, to you first. Do you back Daniel Andrews over this?
Good morning. Yeah, I do, actually. I think that why would we want to import COVID into this country if we didn't have to? I think that there shouldn't be one rule for Victorians and another rule for the rich and powerful global tennis stars. So I think Dan's right on this. And for consistency's sake, it shouldn't be your ability to pay off the rules. You've just got to play by the same standard that everyone else does.
Well, Scott, it would be a glaring case, as Bill points out, of double standards if Novak was allowed to play in Melbourne. But it puts Tennis Australia in a tough spot, doesn't it? Novak's a huge draw card. Do you think the spectators are going to miss him?
Well, I think Tennis Australia just needs to man up and accept that is the reality of us coming out of this pandemic. He needs to be double jabbed to be allowed to come in. I think that the fans, they might be disappointed, but I think they understand in the current situation we're in, they need to have clearly not double standards. And allowing the Joker into Australia, someone who has, for all intents and purposes, been basically an anti-vaxxer, in not being jabbed, I think would be a slap in the face to everyone out there who's got the jab, done the right thing as we try to fight the pandemic.
Bill, as you know better than anyone, everyone in Melbourne has made enormous sacrifices over the last 2 years. Do you think that in the community in Melbourne there is a lot of sympathy for Novak?
No, I suspect most people will say, well, we've done it. Why don't you? Listen, I get there are some people who are unvaccinated who genuinely are afraid of the vaccine. But how on earth do we insist on people getting vaccinated in Australia to do essential work and we don't apply that standard to someone coming from overseas? I mean, if we have to go to other countries, we've got to adhere to their rules. A visa to Australia is a privilege, it's not a right, and you've just got to adhere to the rules. Mm. Simple as that.
It all comes as NRL Chairman Peter Volandis calls for clubs to, quote, go easy on unvaccinated players. He's resisting pressure from some clubs who want to sack players who refuse the jab. Scott, what's your take on that?
Oh, well, look, he's been put under immense pressure because the AFL have said, look, all the players need to be jabbed. I'm surprised by Volandis, who's been very strong on a whole series of issues out there and been willing to take on these kind of issues, that the NRL seems to basically capitulated on this. I know he's saying that 95% of players will be jabbed and somehow that makes it OK. But again, these are role models. The NRL has to send out the right message to the community. And on that basis, I think that he should be doing exactly what the AFL is doing and saying all players need to be jabbed or they're going to be sidelined.
Bill, what's your take on how the NRL is responding to this?
Oh, listen, I think the AFL's got the balance right. I mean, if 95% of people go to work and then catch something from someone who's unvaccinated, they're not very happy and they shouldn't be very happy about that. So, listen, I get it's not easy. Maybe the NRL's got a couple of marquee players who, for whatever reason, don't want the jab and maybe Peter Volandis is trying to navigate that.
Isn't that the same as bringing Novak, not allowing Novak Djokovic into the country?
Exactly.
Isn't that double standards?
Exactly. I mean, exactly. Listen, just roll up your sleeve, get the jab done. It takes about 10 seconds. The vaccine's the reason why we're able to open up and the vaccine's the reason why hopefully our hospitals won't be overrun and the vaccine's the reason why we can get back to normal. The scientists have done a good job. We've got the tools. Let's just do it and finish the job.
OK, let's move on to new.
More now on the growing confusion of whether unvaccinated tennis stars will be allowed to fly in for the Australian Open. Let's bring in clinical epidemiologist Professor Nancy Baxter in Melbourne. Professor, good morning to you. First of all, can I say this? I can't fathom how Tennis Australia can allow unvaccinated players to play when Melbourne has been through what it's been through. It has been absolutely put through the ringer with vaccines heralded as the passports to freedom. Then you allow a spoilt tennis star in without a vaccination. It's completely and utterly tone deaf, I reckon.
Absolutely. I think that, one or two unvaccinated players, if they quarantine for 14 days, probably could be managed with minimal risk. But it sends a terrible message, and not just a message letting them into Australia. Honestly, the professional tennis allowing them to play and continue to put other players at risk. Really, professional athletes should be held to the same standard as, your average person on the street. They should be required and expected to vaccinate as a working individual that it can expose a lot of people to COVID.
Okay, you're 100% right. So the risk of allowing unvaxxed or undeclared players into the country to both players and the wider public, can you outline those for us?
Well, I think the risks are relatively low if they're forced to go into quarantine for 14 days. If you're allowing someone in without any quarantine, I think that there is a risk.
Yeah.
If we're highly vaccinated, I think the risk related to one person coming in is low. But, it kind of opens a door, right? The more people you allow in like that, suddenly you can have outbreaks. So it's just there need to be rules, and everyone needs to follow the rules.
Right.
I don't think that's so difficult for people to understand.
Well, as Dan Andrews said yesterday, you have everyone working around the courts itself. You have all the people who are paying good money for tickets. They've all got to go in there vaccinated, and then to have a player out there, it's just, I can't believe what path they're on. Anyway, let's move on. As the country hits vaccine targets, attention is now turning to booster shots. TGA met yesterday. What are you hearing about how people will find out when they are due and how that'll be administered?
Well, I think that they've been talking in Victoria about notifying people, similar to notifying people post their vaccine to follow up with them. So text messaging, email, that type of thing. It's less clear how people receiving vaccine from other sources will be identified, probably multiple ways in terms of needing their boosters. But I think everyone needs to know boosters, generally, your immunity starts to wane generally about 5 to 6 months. Boosters are probably going to be about at that time period right now. It may be in the future we start to think of the Pfizer Moderna shots as a three dose vaccine, so it requires three doses to get to your maximal immunity. So the timing may change over time,
right.
but that's currently what they're planning. So the first people to get boosted will be the people that were vaccinated very early in the program. So healthcare workers, people who were in aged care, those people will be eligible for boosters first.
The lessons from Israel are pretty stark on this, aren't they? And also in some parts of the UK, that they really do need a top up. Otherwise, it can be quite catastrophic.
Yeah, well, I think that there are two things. One is that for people with a diminished immune system, so people, who say have had cancer and chemotherapy, people who have organ transplants, they don't respond as well to the two doses. Mm. So they actually need three doses. It's not a booster, they need three doses. So that's one thing. And the other thing is that, with waning immunity, for people with a immune system that's not as strong, so the elderly, they can get quite sick as their immunity wanes. The good news for most people is that, the immunity may wane, but you're not... Sorry.
That's all right. Do you know what? I reckon every time we cross to you, there's a garbage truck or there's a wind blower.
Well, it is a high traffic area at 710, it seems, and probably getting more because we're moving around Melbourne. But so people who are in that 5 to 6 month time period and who are healthy, the good news is we don't expect them to require hospitalization or have serious consequences of COVID. The vaccine still works for them. It's just more likely that they're going to get COVID if they're exposed to it.
Yeah.
And what we want to do is reduce the number of people who get COVID and who can transmit COVID. So it's really important that people get that booster. But I don't think people should be running around really worried that they're going to get seriously ill from COVID, if they're, say, a little bit later past that 5 month or 6 month time period. It's still a good vaccine. So we need to get boosted, but we don't need to get boosted this minute.
Very good, Professor, dealing with all those arduous consequences of vehicles being back on the road in Melbourne. Thanks, Professor.